of proportionate build with mousy coloured hair and brown eyes. If you think you know or have seen any of these crooks, please get in touch anonymously with Crime Stoppers on 0800 555 111. Right, that's all we've got time for this week. Many thanks to Philip, Matt and Joe. Stay safe and we'll see you next week for more Crime Suspect.
This is Talk TV.
Want to get to grips with the stories that really matter?
To cut through the spin and the BS.
Want unvarnished and fiery debate?
Then join us for Crosstalk.
1 o'clock every weekday.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV,
on radio, online.
And we're on your smart speaker.
Oh, it's, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia. This is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing Let's Look, Don't Look Back in Anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks. It said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the, you know, the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be a problem if they start breaking into people's homes, because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. They can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham, just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened? Whoa, missing.
There was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no. I've got you both.
Yeah, one at a time. Good.
I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn. What is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised by a special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
Margaret Thatcher, she said, you've got to watch. That was The Woke That Was, 10 o'clock Saturday night with Lizzie Cundy, Henry Bolton, Pete Barnes, and of course, the Woke Webby!
Morning. How are you this morning? It's Christo here on Talk TV. Nice to have your company. With you till 7 o'clock. Welcome to early breakfast. Lots that we're going to be talking about during the course of the next 2 hours. We might reflect on a couple of the stories we spoke about yesterday. I loved our chat about airlines, and I loved our chat about superstitions as well. And Ingrid Tarrant is back. this weekend. I'll tell you why we've got Ingrid again. And we love Ingrid, but we don't normally have people 2 weeks running, but our regular person who we had booked in, unfortunately, couldn't make it. It was Richard Power Saeed. And so Ingrid very, very kindly has stepped into the breach at the last moment. So we're thrilled to have her, and I'm sure she's got an airline story or two that she can share with us. Find out who on the Labour front bench is being accused of being a massive hypocrite this morning. Find out what councils are doing with your recycling, or more importantly, what they're not doing with the rubbish they're insisting you're recycling. Find out which former world leader, who's had quite a good night last night, thinks Prince Harry is a traitor, and we'll hear what you think about what the Conservative Party should have done about Lee Anderson. If anything, 0344 499 1000, wherever you found us this morning, whether it be DAB, whether it be Sky, Virgin, Freeview or Freesat, you're very welcome indeed. It's Christo, it's Early Breakfast, and it's Talk TV. Oh, just going to turn myself down in my ear. I'm a bit loud. Who does the show on a Saturday night? Is it James Whale on a Saturday night? Because whoever is deaf as a post. Do you know, when you work in radio and television, it's really important, this tip. If you ever work in radio and television, I was given a very good piece of advice when I first started out, and that is have your headphones as low as possible, because every single person who's been in radio for years is as deaf as a post. And I notice it. David Bull, when he comes in after me, he puts in his earphones, he says, there's no sound, and that's because I have it so low, because he's as deaf as a post. Because if you've had earpieces in for that long, you go deaf. So there's a little tip for you, and that's why I'm always having a little adjustment under the table, in case you're wondering what I'm doing. It's the earphones, I promise. How are you this morning? I hope you're well. I've still got this cough I can't get rid of. Dr. Renee made me take Cocodamol yesterday. I think she's trying to drug me. She's only human. Oh, by the way, talking to Dr. Renee, I will be with her next weekend because I'm doing breakfast. Did you know that? Did you know that? Well, yeah, I am. Just for one weekend only, I am doing Saturday and Sunday morning breakfast. So I won't be in this slot. I'll be a little bit later, which means I'm going to have to be a bit more newsy. We can't be talking about my mother and superstitions during breakfast. We probably will, in fairness. We probably will. But I can't be doing that during breakfast. What was I up to last night? So I went shopping. So me, myself and him indoors. So we spent a lot of money at the supermarket yesterday. A lot of money. And you know when the cupboards are absolutely bare in your house? And we're sort of stockpilers. So I think, again, it's the Greek thing, because you're always catastrophizing and thinking there's going to be some sort of, you know, nuclear holocaust, so you want to make sure you've got everything in the cupboards. So we don't buy a dishwasher powder or tablets. We buy three. We don't buy a loo roll. We buy five. You know, we make sure that we've got cupboards and cupboards full of... If we see softener, fabric softeners on offer, we'll buy six of them because it's on offer. So we do that sort of shop. And we don't do them very often, but when we do them, oh, my word, is the trolley overflowing. And last night, the trolley was overflowing. What a Saturday night I had with that trolley overflowing. We spent £450 in the supermarket. And we bought everything, you know, Vanish to go in the washing machine. We bought loads of washing powder, you know, washing tablets. We bought fabric softener. We bought the spray for your clothes. We bought spray Febreze. We bought air fresheners. We bought kitchen roll. You know, all of that stuff that costs quite a lot that you need. And so we bought all of it. All of it. It was quite the shop. We bought a new mop. We needed a new mop. Very annoying what's happened with our mop. No, no, I'm annoyed about our mop, right? Can I tell you why I'm annoyed about the mop? I'm going to name and shame a supermarket now. Sainsbury's, I'm talking to you. Because I bought a mop from Sainsbury's, right? And, I mean, do you want to hear about my mop? This is just yet another environmental thing which has irritated me. That's why I'm telling you. So I bought a mop from Sainsbury's like months and months ago. And the other day I opened the understairs cupboard and I was like, oh, that mop's getting a bit whiffy. You know, how many germs are we actually spreading around the floor with that mop head? So I went to Sainsbury's, this was a couple of months ago, and I bought three new mop heads, right? And which is what you do, right? I went to Sainsbury's, bought these new mop heads, got home, I threw away the old mop head, I said, that's getting a bit manky. Went to put the new mop head on, and they've changed the mop heads don't fit the handle anymore. Because they're supposed to be universal, but they don't. They've changed the handle because the new handle's more environmentally friendly. So I've ended up in this strange situation now where I've had to throw out a perfectly good mop handle. So yesterday I had to buy the new mop to match the new mop heads that I'd bought already. And that is because the new mop is more environmentally friendly. You can tell it's sort of more recycled. And so how is that environmentally friendly that I had to throw away a perfectly good mop handle? So anyway, that was really annoying. So we bought that. So we did all of the shopping. And the other thing we did was we bought something that was very expensive because my neighbour, I'm going to tell you a little secret here now. Don't tell anyone, right? My neighbour, my elderly neighbour, who has become a very, very dear friend of mine, she's wonderful, wonderful. She's a slightly racist Barbadian woman. And she is. It's very difficult to navigate. I love her dearly, but she... I'll tell you why I called her slightly racist. She's not really racist, but she rents her flat out, and she always says, I don't want any black people. And you say, well, you can't say that. I say to her, you can't say that. But she's black herself. So how do you navigate that? It's like meeting your best friend that's gay that's actually homophobic. You say, well, hang on, you can't be homophobic. So it's very difficult to navigate that. But I've got a brilliant text here. I'll read it in a second. So it's her 90th birthday on Monday, and Muggins here because how often do you turn 90? So we're throwing her a little do. Myself and him indoors. So we've got all the neighbours coming round. We've got the old lady across the road. We've got the old lady next door, his birthday. We've got the old man across the road who was so chuffed that we invited him. Oh, my word. He was so happy. This really elderly gentleman, I've never really spoken to him before, but he's lived on the road as long as she has. So we went and invited him, and he was practically in tears. He was so chuffed to be invited. So I'm not sure we're ever going to be able to get rid of him. So neighbours two doors up, the neighbours the other side, they're all coming on Monday for a little do that we're throwing for my 90-year-old neighbour because it's actually her birthday. So we were buying all the things like, quiches. I nearly was going to make a quiche. Have you ever tried to make a quiche? Oh, it's so much hassle. So we bought some nice quiches. We bought some nice party food. I'm going to make a cake. Going to make a Victoria sponge. So we bought all the ingredients for that, and I'm going to put whipped cream in the middle of it, so we're getting all of that. And all of that is quite pricey. The butter for all of that, it is quite a lot of money. So that was what I ended up doing last night, but I was so irritated by this mop. And I really wanted to just go up to them in Sainsbury's and say, I want to take this mop. I'm only buying this because you've changed the mop head. And that takes me to another story this morning, which is in the Express. And it is about recycling as well. It's one of those false recycling stories. Really irritating. And apparently, councils, the councils that charge you a fortune if you don't recycle, or they'll leave your rubbish on the side if you don't recycle, or they're reducing your bin collections because recycling's so important. That's what my council's doing, as I've bored you with week after week. Well, apparently, less than half of household waste is being recycled by councils. And the Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs emerged this data. Government inspectors were last week sent in to examine whether councils are meeting their legal requirements to provide efficient and cost-effective services. And apparently the average recycling rate across the councils, so these are the councils themselves that are recycling your rubbish, not you recycling. You've recycled it already. You've given it to the council, and then they're not bothering recycling it. So the councils are charging you for recycling and making sure that you do all the recycling, and they're not taking your rubbish if you haven't recycled properly, and then they themselves aren't recycling it themselves. 43%, nearly 60%, two-thirds of councils aren't recycling your rubbish for you. It's unbelievable. Tower Hamlets is the worst. They blame their poor performance on a rapidly growing and dense population. I would say it's the council that's pretty dense. And said a new home building programme had outstripped its ability to recycle domestic waste more effectively. They said 9,000 homes were built between 2019 and 2022, but recycling facilities are not keeping pace. The sheer numbers of people, ageing housing stock and shared facilities make recycling much more difficult. Add to that the thousands of visitors and workers that come to our borough every day, and you can see it's challenging. So, what's the point? What is the point in recycling if they're not even bothering doing it themselves? And I bet you a pound to a pinch of the proverbial, they will charge you if you don't do it properly, or leave your rubbish festering if they notice that it's, you know, what's the word? Contaminated. Which is, you know, because there's, I don't know, there's like a, there's a crisp packet in it that isn't recyclable. And unfortunately, what we're going to have to start doing where I live is hiding normal rubbish in the recycling now. So, I mean, that, well, I'm probably one of the people to blame, because they've decided in my borough that they're only going to let you collect normal rubbish once a fortnight. So me and my partner have been sort of racking our brains going, what are we going to do? Because we're going to have too much rubbish. So we've decided we're going to have to hide it in the recycling bin and hope they still take it. Which you're not supposed to do, but how else are we going to get this rubbish taken? Oh, all this green nonsense. I wouldn't mind all this green nonsense if it was actually for a good cause and it was making our lives easier and better, but it isn't. It's just constantly an excuse to fleece us more. Constantly. I was just texting you this morning, telling you not to be annoying, as I've got a headache, but unfortunately, before I managed to finish the message, it was too late. How rude. Oh, I'm quite annoying. Imagine what I'm like living with myself. 24 hours a day I've got to put up with this. At least you get a break. At least you only get me for 4 hours a week. Imagine. Another one here as well. You must have been shopping in a cost-cutter type store, says Catherine in Norwich. No, it was the big Sainsbury's. We were going and doing that massive, great big shop of absolute everything. Cans of Coke, we bought them. My partner drinks a lot of oat milk. We bought, like, you know, six of those. You know, when you just buy as many as you can of everything, and especially, like I say, if it's on offer. So we bought absolutely loads of that tuna. You know, you really see how expensive everything is as well. Shorty wants me to do... Do you really? Shorty says, it's time you realise how much we love Christo. We want to see more of him. Make him start at 5 a.m. and do breakfast. I mean, if I got the fee, I would. Do you know what? I still think by 10 a.m, though, I'd have more to talk about. I really do. I think by 10, I've still got stuff to tell you. You know, I didn't tell you about something that happened yesterday. Thank you. Oh, bless you, Ollie. In Middlesex as well. The best part of the day, whatever the side of the bed you fall out of, Christo puts you mentally right back on the correct side of the bed. Yeah, that sounds a bit pervy, Ollie. Sounds like I'm in your bedroom with you, you know, trying to put you in bed, which I'm not sure in these days in media is a thing you're allowed to say. Catherine also says we were robbed. No, we really were. I should have brought the receipt in for you. That would have been quite interesting. We could have... I'm going to put it on the screen. No, I don't want you to see everything. I don't want you to see how much loo roll I'm buying. You'll think I've got a problem. We were talking about my weak bladder yesterday. No, I was not bringing my loo roll. Kitchen roll, we bought like 12 rolls of kitchen roll. Bin bags, oh yeah, we got the bin bags. We got the bin bags, we got the... Forever we're doing the garden stuff, we got the thick bin bags. We got the thin bin bags as well. And then we got the pedal bin bags as well. So we got three sets of bin bags. Do you know, we bought things like as well. We bought things like greaseproof paper for the oven, things like that. Tin foil, greaseproof paper, cling film as well. I mean, that's going to shoot the recycling, you know. We bought those. All of that stuff, all of tins, you know, tin sweet corn. My him indoors loves his tin sweet corn in a salad. So tins of everything. We literally, we had two trolleys full of stuff. It was unbelievable. Biscuits as well, because I love a gluten-free oat biscuit. That's my biscuit of choice. But they're pricey as well. All of these things are so expensive nowadays. Oh, and food for the dogs as well, because you know we cook for the dogs. So we bought them their chicken, their steak, their fish, their rice, their broccoli, their frozen broccoli, all of that stuff as well we bought. We did not go to the self-service checkout. Absolutely not. No, I spoke to a person at the checkout. And that's absolutely what I do. I do not go to the self-service checkout. Well, I've got a couple of items I might. But also, I just don't get on with the woman. I'm sorry. Unexpected item in the bagging area. Just leave me alone, honestly. It's like going shopping with my mother. I don't want to hear it. I really don't. I'm sick of... And the poor person, I always feel so sorry for the person who works on the self-checkout bit. You know, darting between person to person. They must have the most busy shift. Because constantly that little red light is going on. And it's an absolute nightmare. Hey, mind you, there's a story this morning I saw that apparently they're putting security tags on £2 Easter eggs now because so many people are nicking them. So I think, I'm sorry, but if some things just go through at the self-checkout, right, then that's supermarket's fault. It really is. You don't want people to steal, then have tills. Have tills again. Oh, we bought some champagne as well. That was the other thing that put the bill up. Notice I just say that at the end. And it's all for the little do on Monday. It's all for the little party that we're having on Monday. We're having scones. I'm baking a cake. We're having quiche. We're having sausage rolls. Smoked salmon and cream cheese sandwiches. So I'm doing a lovely little spread. I'm doing it myself. You know, these hands will be making the everything. Well, I say making everything, taking the quiche out of the packet. And so hopefully it'll be a lovely do for her. And when we return, not only will we talk about more of the recycling that isn't being done, find out why Angela Rayner is being called a massive hypocrite this morning, and we'll try and dissect whether the Tory party did the right thing with Lee Anderson and whether he should have apologised for what he said about Sadiq Khan. So all of that and more when we return live here on Talk TV.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV,
on radio,
online.
And we're on your smart speaker.
Oh, it's, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia. This is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing Let's Look, Don't Look Back in Anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks. It said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the, you know, the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be your problem if they start breaking into people's homes because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. And they can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I'll tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened? Whoa, missing.
there was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for the release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no, I've got you both.
Yeah, one at a time.
Good. I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn, what is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised
by
a special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
Morning, it's Christo here on Talk TV. Now, we must talk this morning about the comments of Lee Anderson. Now, he was would you call him a former Tory now? I mean, he's still a member of the Conservative Party, but he's had the Tory whip removed. He was the former deputy chairman of the Tory Party, and this is because of comments he made on television the other night regarding the repellent little runt, Sadiq Khan, who is, of course, our London mayor. Now, if you don't know what Lee Anderson said, he basically made comments regarding... Well, he was reacting to something Suella Braverman had been saying, and to cut a long story short, Lee Anderson said that Islamists had got control of the London mayor and that they were essentially all his friends when he was talking about what's happening in London at the moment. So, firstly, I'd love to hear from you about whether you think removing the whip from Lee Anderson was the right thing to do. Secondly, I'd like to know whether you think he should have apologised. I am really irritated by this story. Not maybe for the reasons that you might think, but I am irritated by this story because, as you know, I have a particularly special depth of feeling for the London mayor, Sadiq Khan, as someone who's lived in London for the entire time he's been mayor. I absolutely loathe him. I think that he is repellent. I think that he is public relations focused. I think that he is divisive. I think that he is awful. But I think Lee Anderson's comments were wrong. And I'll tell you why. I think that they are probably what you would call casual racism. And what's irritating about this, there are many things that are irritating about this story, but what is irritating about this story is that it's actually removed the focus from what could have been quite a fair point about what's going on in London. We are seeing threats from people who are more radical in their Islamic faith. We are seeing people who are MPs who are being threatened by those people who are protesting every weekend. We are seeing a situation. There's stories in the newspapers today where more MPs need protection every single day. Bodyguards for MPs on the front pages this morning. Now, those are people who are extreme in their Islamic faith. Now, if you want to protest about what's happening to Palestinian people, I think that's absolutely reasonable if you want to do that. If you're going to make chants or threaten people when you do those protests, chants that are anti-Jewish, then you are extreme and you are wrong. And that is something that is happening in London. The issue with what he said, Lee Anderson, this is tarring Sadiq Khan with the same brush just because he is a Muslim. And the reason I'm irritated about this is because I firstly think that Lee Anderson should have just apologised, because I think it was a misjudged thing to say. The other thing that's irritating is that now the fair point about what's happening in London is now not being discussed, because everyone's discussing this racism that has happened, which could have been quashed had he just said sorry. So that's irritating. But more irritating than that is that it has now given Sadiq Khan the moral high ground. Sadiq Khan is absolutely loving this. He's absolutely loving playing the victim here and taking the moral high ground. A moral high ground that he's entitled to, because what was said was wrong. And it's just irritating to me that you're giving this man, a man that is so repellent and a man that is so divisive, you're giving him the moral high ground. You're giving him an easy win by saying something so stupid. So Lee Anderson was wrong and stupid to say it, but Sadiq Khan now sort of pontificating in such a pious manner, saying that it was pouring fuel on the fire of anti-Muslim hatred and all of these things as well. I'm afraid there's deafening silence from Rishi Sunak and all of this stuff. It's not good enough in the United Kingdom. All of these things that Sadiq Khan is saying about this, and this is a time where we shouldn't have comments to divide us. You now have a man, Sadiq Khan this is, who is taking the moral high ground about being divisive, when he is clearly one of the most divisive politicians that we have. It is not Lee Anderson, it's Sadiq Khan who referred to moderate Muslims himself back in 2016. It was revealed in an interview that he called them Uncle Toms. Sadiq Khan said that, no one else. Sadiq Khan put out literature from TfL that showed a white family where they were told, where it was said that they don't represent real Londoners. That's Sadiq Khan being divisive, no one else. Sadiq Khan was the one that said that if you were opposed to the ultra-low emission zone in London, you were aligned with the far right. That's divisive. Sadiq Khan has presided over more young black men and young people from ethnic minorities being stabbed in our city and killed than any other mayor in history. That is divisive. So do not give this repellent little man an easy win by saying such stupid comments. Anyone in the Tory party, anyone in politics, because it is Sadiq Khan who is divisive, and it is those people who make stupid comments like Lee Anderson who is also divisive, and it is just an easy win for such an awful little man. So there we go. And I think Lee Anderson should have just apologised, drawn a line under it, and moved on. But I'd love to know what you think of this. 0344 499 1000 is the number to call. OK, before we get back to some of your calls, we're going to be speaking to Kinsey very shortly with her Right Royal Roundup. But let's have a look at some of the texts and tweets coming in. Sadiq Khan should have come out and condemned the projection of that anti-Semitic chant on Big Ben, but he said nothing. I think his silence as mayor says more than Lee Anderson's remarks, says Rachel. Well, Rachel, I think that's why you've got to be smart. Not you, but those politicians around Sadiq Khan have got to be smart, because all that does, you're quite right, that's a really fair criticism of Sadiq Khan. Very, very fair indeed. Now, we've given Sadiq Khan ammunition against all of that. That's what irritates me about this. Not only was what Lee Anderson said wrong, because it was a gross generalisation about someone, and if you'd said it about anyone else, it would have been just as wrong. If he'd said that, you know, it was a Jewish mayor helping his Jewish mates, that would be wrong as well. So not only is it irritating and wrong on that level, but what you've done is now handed Sadiq Khan the ammunition to take the moral high ground. And now no one is talking, Rachel, about what was projected on Parliament. And they're now talking about Lee Anderson being, you know, apparently a racist instead. And So it's an easy win. It could have been an easy win against Sadiq Khan, this awful man who has divided London in a way that I have never seen before. And now no one's talking about the divisions around London. They're all talking about Lee Anderson. So I think just my advice would be that firstly, don't make stupid comments, but also you've got to be smart around this whole thing. I think Lee Anderson was totally right. I want him to be Prime Minister, but people in this country are so spineless, says Wayne. Well, I don't think that he's smart enough to be Prime Minister. Look, I see the appeal of Lee Anderson because he is someone who sort of speaks his mind and doesn't really think that much before he speaks, and we're sick to death of politicians that tiptoe. And I understand that appeal. But if he were Prime Minister, as I said, we would be talking more and more about the way in which he delivers his comments and not about the problems in society. Because now all of London's issues are off the agenda. All that anyone's talking about is his racism. Let's talk to Andrew in Bedford about this. Morning to you, Andrew.
Good morning, Christo.
Oh, it's very loud in my ear. I'm going to turn you down a little bit. Andrew, what do you think about what I just said about Lee Anderson? And you know, he was wrong to make his comments, but he should have just apologised because it was wrong, right?
Well, yeah, he did put him in a clumsy way, but as I was saying to your researcher, I think a lot of Muslims are racist, and also this country is going to become a Muslim republic within 10 generations, because there was a survey done of the 2011 census, and if the birth rate amongst Muslims continued compared to non-Muslims, within 10 generations they calculated that this country would be under Sharia law, and that's not right. I mean, you
are... Well, OK, well, I'm not familiar with that particular piece of research, and there are lots of people that would listen to this, Andrew, and would challenge it and say that you're saying things that are going to scare people or that aren't true and all of these sorts of things. So I just think we need to be careful when we say things like that. But I understand where you're coming from, and I understand the issues that you're worried about with that. However, isn't it frustrating to you that therefore then if there is an issue with Islamism in London, if there is a problem with Islamists in London, aren't you frustrated that now all that anyone's talking about is Lee Anderson?
Well, it's wrong, yeah, but, I mean, the biggest problem with London is that the Metropolitan Police are absolutely useless at upholding the law. They seem to shy away from Muslims, that they can't offend them, do anything to offend them, and that is totally wrong.
Well, look, I absolutely agree there have been examples of that, massive examples, and it's not just... in London, I think we've seen it across the UK when it came to the grooming gangs and things like that. Absolutely get that. The problem is, the problem that I'm finding incredibly frustrating with this story is that, again, that is a very valid point about the Met Police. That is a very valid point about people feeling intimidated when it comes to some of these protest marches that are taking place. And the Met Police, I think it's a fair criticism of them that they are not doing their job properly. What a shame that that's now not being spoken about. What a shame that Sadiq Khan has been handed the moral high ground to deflect all of that by now talking about Lee Anderson instead.
Well, he hasn't been handed the moral high ground, in my opinion, because, you know, he's just, as you say, he's a loathsome creature. I don't know...
Well, he's divisive himself, and he's got a way...
There's so many immigrants and that...
There is a different standard to people on the left than there is to people on the right. Whether we like that or not, that is the truth. If you are on the left and you say something that is divisive or racist, you can apologise, as Sadiq Khan did, and sort of get away with it. If you say it on the right, there is far more of a furore about it. And someone like Lee Anderson should know that and should have acted accordingly. And it's the frustration of the stupidity that I find annoying about that, because he knows how things work. He knows how this stuff works. And as far as I'm concerned, you can't make those kinds of generalisations and expect to get away with it. And when you do, Not only is it wrong on a moral level, but you give your opponent an easy win. And that's what's happened here. Andrew, thank you very much. We're going to take a break a little early because when we come back, I think we've got Kinsey now ready on the line, and we'll find out what she's got to say in our Right Royal Roundup next here on Talk TV.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV,
on radio, online.
And we're on your smart speaker.
Oh, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia, this is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing Let's Look, Don't Look Back in Anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks. It said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the, you know, the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be your problem if they start breaking into people's homes, because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. They can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham, just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened?
Whoa, missing.
There was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for the release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no, I've got you both.
Yeah.
You can't.
Good.
I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn, what is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised
by
a special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
OK, it's Christo here on Talk TV. By the way, I'm getting lots and lots of reactions, excuse me, to what I said about Lee Anderson and whether it's diverting attention away from some of the real issues. And I really appreciate those. And we're going to do our Right Royal Roundup, but afterwards I will read some of those out and I'll talk to Ingrid about it as well. So don't think that I'm ignoring those texts and tweets. But we must get on to, as we do on a Sunday, at this time, every week, it's our Right Royal Roundup.
Kinsey's Right Royal Roundup.
Now, nice to say hello to Kinsey Schofield. Where have you been, Kinsey Schofield? Because have you been in Vegas or have you been showbizzing around the world?
I wish I could see you. I can't see you. I'm just staring at myself. So if I start, like, glowing heart eyes, it's because I like my eyelashes today, but hopefully I'll be able to see you in a second on the screen. I did do Vegas this week. I do a couple of parties in LA. I left my house this week. I felt pretty content with myself.
Amazing. I'm glad that you did that. I'm glad, and I'm upset you can't see me at the moment.
I know.
I'm gesturing as we speak. I won't say what gesture, but I am gesturing as we speak. Let's get you up to date with some of the big royal stories of the week. Now, firstly, I've got to talk about this story from yesterday. I don't know if you caught it, but it was the one where the defence of the Department of Homeland Security, I don't know if you saw this story, but Homeland Security at the moment are defending themselves against the Heritage Group, which is this think tank that have asked to see Prince Harry's immigration papers and tried to get them made public to see whether he declared that he'd taken loads of drugs. And the lawyers for the Department of Homeland Security said, oh, no, you can't actually believe anything that he wrote in the book Spare, because he might have exaggerated. And I just found it hilarious that now lawyers who are arguing the side of Prince Harry, they're not Prince Harry's lawyers, but lawyers that are arguing the side of Prince Harry to keep his immigration stuff secret, they're actually saying you can't believe a word he says.
Right. That, well, I mean, I'm sure that Hunter Biden's attorneys want us to think the same thing. Oh, don't believe those laptop pictures. Those are exaggerated. I saw that argument and I thought, I hope the Heritage Group has prepared that interview that Prince Harry gave. And I forgive me because I wasn't too prepped to discuss this, so I apologize. We just decided to talk about this story. But is it Dr. Gabe Matisse? It's Prince Harry did a sit down interview with a doctor where he openly discussed the drug use, and that was a one-on-one interview that you had to purchase tickets for, but that exists. I think he went more into the drug use in that sit-down interview than he did with Anderson Cooper or with Bradby.
Tom Bradby as well. So you're quite right. And actually, when I discussed this briefly yesterday, so many people made exactly that point. You're absolutely right. Saying, well, hang on, it wasn't just in the book that he said that he was taking, you know, more magic mushrooms than one of the Beatles in the 60s. He actually said it in numerous interviews. So how can you take that with a grain of salt? Unless, of course, we are to believe that he will literally say anything to sell books, which I'm starting to think might be the case. I loved that Gabe Matisse interview, by the way, where people had to pay to listen to him prattle on about his problems, but they did get a free copy of the book Spare at the end of it, which is nice.
Right. And then Gabe actually said later, remember, that he regretted doing that interview, that it was emotionally draining, the reaction to being associated with Prince Harry. And then they both hated the idea of monetizing, this what was supposed to be this pure sit down that was really supposed to get into the nitty gritty of Harry's pain. Not only did they monetize it, but people that had already purchased the book had to basically repurchase the book through that. So it would be interesting if that interview blew up in his face after the interviewer has already said, I regret that interview.
Yeah. Oh my God. Well, you know, you might need more copies of the book because you might need a doorstop or an assailant might come in and literally hundreds
according to how much toilet paper you just had to purchase and how expensive it was, you might need to use it as toilet paper in the future. I don't know your life, but like you spent a lot on toilet paper.
Well, to be honest, yes. I mean, you know, bearing in mind my views on the book, I think that might be the most appropriate place for it. Okay, where would you like to go next? We've got King Charles and Prince William. We've got Meghan Markle's ex-best friend. Should we do that one?
Oh, yeah. And I hope you see my notes on this. Yes. We have to behave ourselves. So this is Jessica Maroney. Jessica was a famous stylist who is married to a big-time entertainment correspondent in Canada, whose father was the prime minister. So Jessica and Meghan befriended each other when Meghan was on Suits. This was a really good contact for Meghan Markle at the time, because remember, she was not at the top of the call sheet when it came to Suits. She was looking for contacts like Jessica. Jessica introduced her to incredible political figures, to the Trudeaus. Jessica dressed her fiercely on red carpets. So Jessica was a great in for Meghan when she was in Canada.
Oh, well, that's really lovely. So Meghan has obviously, you know, repaid Jessica by staying in touch with her, being a loyal friend, remaining best friends with her because Jessica was there for her in those early years when work wasn't really as brilliant as it is now?
Unfortunately, no. And if you'll recall from the Netflix series, Meghan is on the phone and recording Prince Harry's proposal. Do you remember that? She's talking to Jessica and she's like screen recording and she's like, I think he's going to do it. And she like walks outside and he's getting ready to propose to her. Do you remember that on
yes.
the Netflix special?
Yes, of course. I've forgotten about that.
And it's so strange because when the Netflix special came out, Meghan had already stopped talking to Jessica. And Jessica, just to kind of acknowledge it, posted a group picture from Meghan's wedding. Meghan's not in the photo, but a big group of their mutual friends from the wedding. And so there's been this weird, Jessica kind of acknowledges Meghan since the falling out in 2020 through kind of vague and kind and, you know, kind of vague quotes and old school pictures, but never addresses their falling out directly.
What did they fall out about? Do we know?
Yes. So when the Black Lives Matter, you know, kind of when Black Lives Matter was a big movement happening, it started in America and it really blew up globally. An influencer posted something that Jessica reacted to. It was something about white privilege. Jessica kind of snapped back at her and the woman called her out and Jessica was basically canceled. And in that moment, you saw Meghan Markle kind of back away from her because she didn't want to be associated with it.
What a good friend Meghan is, standing by someone during those terrible times. So basically, Jessica makes, I don't know the comment that Jessica made, but Jessica makes a comment that was probably throwaway, was probably not wise at the time. And Meghan, who was incredibly helped by her, was given access to all these people, ditches her like a hot stone.
Right. And so the story that's circulating today is that Jessica's back on the street. She kind of, I don't want to say she went into hiding, but she just definitely, you know, she lost her job with Good Morning America over that scandal. She lost her friend Meghan over it. And they're saying she's back on the scene. She's dressing celebrities again. She's, you know, putting herself out there and she's comfortable and confident again. So we should, you know, we should anticipate seeing more of Jessica. And so that's the story. And we're seeing a lot more of Meghan Markle. Could there be a reunion potentially? I don't know. But I will say, I thought that Meghan dressed impeccably when she had Jessica on board to help her navigate her style.
Well, she probably didn't need Jessica anymore, in fairness, after she was banned from wearing any colours as a member of the royal family, which not only was terrible for her wardrobe, but also racist because the word colour was mentioned.
Well, we did see her this week and not only cream, but grey. So grey, black, cream.
Grey, black.
And I love when she does the Elizabeth Holmes turtleneck. Every time she wears a turtleneck, which is often, I'm reminded of Elizabeth Holmes, that grifter, the blood testing grifter.
Oh, right. Oh, OK. Yes, I understand. Does that mean she means business when she's wearing a roll neck like that, do you think?
I think it means she's a grifter.
Oh, all right. Well, we knew that already. We absolutely knew that already. OK, well, all I'll say, Jessica, if you're watching, proceed with caution if you're going to make friends again, because she will drop you like she drops everyone else. She's a ruthless woman, that Meghan. I kind of love her for that, though. I do love her for that. I love how ruthless she is. I wish I could be like that. I like people. I sort of get on with people. I want to be friends with people. I wish I could be ruthless. I would ditch you, Kinsey, if I could. I'd get rid.
I think that I would not mind it if I felt like there were any sincere relationships in her life. But it seems like there's only Tyler Perry, only Oprah, and only Harry, and only her mom. Like, I just wonder, is she lonely? I mean, I'm serious. Is she lonely? Because who has she stayed connected to? Who is still, and I, you know, it, this is of her own doing. But I do wonder if that element of her life, it makes her a lonely individual.
Yeah, I suppose, does she have any real friends? You know, I'd like, I think in showbiz,
it's difficult to find real friends, actually. I think I'm being absolutely serious now. I think it is quite difficult to have friends and to know whether those friends really adore you or whether they want a piece of you or whether they, they want to look good around you and all of those things. And if you get into the industry without long-term friends who you've had for sort of 20 years that have got your back, I think it is incredibly lonely. And I think you're right. I think she may well be, actually, deep down, quite a lonely woman, because it must be exhausting as well. You know, if you read the Tom Bauer book and how she was constantly on and constantly looking for the next step and looking for the next step up and looking for the next person that would help her, you would be exhausted by the end of that.
Well, and there were rumors at the time when you saw the disconnect between Meghan and Jessica, because it was extreme. There were rumors at the time that Meghan felt like Jessica was benefiting too much in association with her friendship. Jessica was a Canadian personality, why all of a sudden is Good Morning America giving her a gig? You know, Jessica had a new wedding planning or wedding show that was going to launch right before this scandal happened, and that was canceled. And there were rumors at the time that Meghan was kind of irritated by Jessica's glow up due to her association with her. So I, you know, based on what you were just saying, there's got to be some sense of, do people want this relationship because of what I can do for them? But in reality, Jessica helped Meghan get ahead quite a bit.
Yeah, well, that's insecurity as well. That's insecurity on Meghan's part. This idea that there is a limited pie and, you know, I'll take your piece of the pie when I need help, but now that I've made it and you're getting a piece of my pie, no, I don't like it. I don't like you having a piece of my pie. I mean, just generally, I don't like anyone else eating my pie in general.
I don't like to share.
I don't like to share either. But you know, that's really, it's not very magnanimous, shall we say. All right, let's talk about the Prince and Princess of Wales. Because I haven't heard this story, but some people are saying, look, we need some reassurance about what's happening with Princess Catherine.
Yes, this is coming from Newsweek, and I was really surprised by this. This is Newsweek's head royal commentator and royal writer coming out saying that Prince William and the Princess of Wales need to reassure the public that everything's okay. We need to see them. We need to see her. We need to hear from her. And Christo, I can't stress to you enough how much I disagree with this. I feel like they were so open with us by telling us you will see the Princess of Wales around Easter, which is coming up. It's coming up next month. It's not, it's just a few weeks away. We've seen a lot, almost too much of Prince William recently, which actually is that's not true. I love seeing Prince William, but you know what I mean. We've seen a significant amount of Prince William lately, and I just thought, you know, there has got to be a line that we draw in our expectations of these people. And if there is somebody that is actually recovering, healing, recuperating from something, let's give that person some space. I mean, Newsweek is a very respected publication. I thought that this was kind of out of line.
I'll tell you why this misses the mark as well, because, and this is something that you'll appreciate, there's protocol involved. We saw this week for the first time the King since his treatment and getting all of those get well cards and the like. That's who we're going to see first. We're not going to see Princess Catherine first. We'll see the King first. Now, we will see her, but you're not going to see Princess Catherine first, then the King after his health scare. It's going to be the other way round. So, actually, I don't think that's been considered in this story.
Well, and, you know, Prince William has slightly addressed it in the only way that they know how, which is through hinting, well, in the only way that they feel comfortable with, I should say, in hinting at it. When he says at the BAFTAs, well, I really haven't had a chance to see all of the films because I've been busy. I mean, that's him hinting at things going on at home, more important things going on at home.
He's bringing Catherine a like nice tray of scones and he's making her cups of tea and all of that. You'd love that. You'd love to have Prince William at your bedside, wouldn't you, Kinsey? Honestly. Apparently, King Charles, Prince William, closer than ever at the moment. We've got 1 minute left to tell us about that.
Okay, so this is coming from the Daily Beast. They talked to a friend, an insider, they said that Prince William and the King are incredibly close, the closest they've ever been. And Prince William agrees and understands that the King wants to reunite with Prince Harry. However, the fact that Prince Harry had that did that Good Morning America interview immediately after their conversation is proof enough to Prince William that he's going to continue to keep his distance from his brother.
Well, there we go. And we'll see what happens in the future. But listen, thank you so much, Kinsey, for our Right Royal Roundup.
Christo's Right Royal Roundup.
Looking forward to doing that once again next week. Coming up in the next hour, we've got Ingrid coming in. She's doing all of the newspapers, some of the big stories next.
This is Talk TV.
Want to get to grips with the stories that really matter?
To cut through the spin and the BS.
Want unvarnished and fiery debate?
Then join us for Crosstalk.
1 o'clock every weekday.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV,
on radio, online.
And we're on your smart speaker.
Oh, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia, this is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing Let's Look, Don't Look Back in Anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks. It said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be a problem if they start breaking into people's homes because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. They can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened? Ooh,
there was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for the release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no. Sorry, I've got you both.
Yeah.
You can't.
Good.
I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn. What is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised
you're
by a special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
That's the ghost of Margaret Thatcher. She said you've got to watch. That was The Woke That Was, 10 o'clock Saturday night with Lizzie Cundy, Henry Bolton, Pete Barnes and, of course, the Woke Webby!
Morning, it's Christo here on Talk TV. How are you? Thanks so much for your company this morning. Really good to have you on board. Loads that we've been discussing, including how the Conservative Party should react or have reacted to Lee Anderson's comments about Sadiq Khan. I think those comments were wrong. I'm sorry. Maybe I stand alone saying it, but I think his comments were wrong. Does that make him a full-on racist? No, but it was a racist comment. Or at least it was an anti-Muslim comment. I don't know whether you can conflate the two as easily as people do, but it was wrong. And I think you should just apologise. But maybe you disagree. 03444991000. The councils that aren't recycling your rubbish, we'll talk about that. And we must talk this hour about whether Labour's Angela Rayner is a hypocrite. Because, well, she's benefited from a scheme, a very, very Tory scheme, that she actually wants to reform because she opposes parts of it. So, big, big talk of Angela Rayner hypocrisy this morning, so we'll talk about that. Plus, a couple of other stories in the newspapers this morning as well. And we might even talk a little bit about superstitions as well, because we did a bit about that yesterday as well. So, lots for us to discuss all here live. It's Talk TV. And I have to thank someone for stepping into the breach because you were a last minute saviour, weren't you, Ingrid, this morning?
The bottom of the barrel, was it?
Well, unfortunately, the person that we had booked was indisposed and you stepped in.
I stepped in, but that's amazing. I do that.
You
that's,
do,
that's
and you're not
me.
Bottom of the barrel. You're midway, at least, up the barrel.
Okay, that's not
you're
so
definitely
bad.
Midway up the barrel. No, so thank you, because I know that you did this last week as well, and you've probably got better things to do with your Sundays than sit here and talk
well,
to
I'm
me.
Going to see the Lion King later on today.
Are
I'm
you?
I'm taking my eldest grandson
are
for
you?
The matinee, yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, it'd be lovely. So, no, this fits in really well, because I've still got the rest of the day.
Oh, see, it's perfect.
Perfect.
All right, let's talk about the Lee Anderson story. So he's now had the Conservative whip taken from him, suspended from the Conservative whip. He actually gave a statement saying, look, I realise I've put the party and Rishi Sunak in quite a difficult position. I don't know if you heard at the start there, but actually what is irritating about this is that I feel that what was probably a fair point regarding extreme elements of people of the Islamic faith and their protests in London and what they've been doing and the intimidation some people have been feeling. I think that was an absolutely fair point. And I think Sadiq Khan, not having control of that as his role as head of the Met Police, again, is a fair point. It was that connection that they have control of him and that they're his mates, I think, that was the misjudged comment there. And he should have just apologised for it, because now everyone's talking about Lee Anderson and they're not actually talking about what was quite a fair point. So that's what I think.
Mm.
What do you think, Ingrid?
Oh, here we go.
No, go on.
Yes,
oh, I
know. I think we have to dissect this into three parts.
Okay.
Because you've got, on the one hand, you have got I don't know even where to sort of like how to dissect it, because it's so interconnected. So we do have an issue. We do have an issue with Sadiq Khan. You and I have discussed this before. We wanted to use his book as an alternative for loo paper, didn't we? You know,
that's the second time that's come up this morning on someone's book. But anyway, go on.
Oh, has it? Oh, yeah.
Because Kinsey was suggesting I do the same with Prince Harry's book.
Oh, I see. Well, do you know, we never need to buy loo paper
again,
actually.
Yes.
Exactly. I can't bear the man.
Yeah.
So, and then you have to put into context him and the relationship and how he is Mayor of London. How is he?
Well, I think that's
because
fair.
A lot of people believe, and this is what Lee Anderson is perhaps alluding to as well, and believe, not just think, but really believe, that he, there's an arrangement there. They're in each other's pockets. And that is quite a Muslim thing to do. They look after each other. I do know that, and they fund each other.
No, but again, I think that the issue that I have with those comments, and where the issue with those comments is that he wasn't saying, though I'm not sure this would be much better, that it was Islamist. Islamist is a term that
exactly.
you use for extremist.
That's what it implies, where he's actually referring
to
Muslims.
Whereas what he should... Yeah. Now, again, I'm not... I don't wholly love the idea that... Because, again, you're making a presumption then, rightly or wrongly, that because Sadiq Khan is a Muslim himself, that therefore he's incapable of being impartial when it comes to the policing of Muslims in London. And again, that could be lead to an accusation of being racist by saying... Because again, if you were to say that about well, again, either racist or anti-Muslim, because I'm not sure I completely also agree with the sort of conflation of race and religion here. But I think that if you were to say it about anyone else, about any other type of person, i.e., you know, imagine if you were to say about Kebbi Badenoch, oh, you know, well, she's just looking after her black mates. You know, that would be seen as deeply offensive.
Yeah, I know. But we're finding... I do think we should take things much more face value and not overthink it, because we are so conscious and so afraid of saying anything that might be interpreted as racist, that then it's very easy to pounce on something like this, which is why I think it's very easy to pounce on Anderson.
But should he have just apologised and said, look, the point
no,
I was making...
No, I don't think he should.
Oh, see, I think he should have, because I think that would have... What I would have said, if I was advising Lee Anderson, I mean, again, and I understand that people don't want a false apology, and if he doesn't really feel he wants to apologise, then I get it. But I'd have said, look, you know, allude to the fact that you were making a fair point, because actually the fact that there is a problem with extreme Islamist protests in London is an absolutely fair point. And the fact that Sadiq Khan doesn't have control of that in his role of in the Met,
he? But why
that's
should
a fair
he?
Point as well.
But why should he have control? You see, this
well,
is...
Well, he's really... head of Met. He's the head of the Met Police. The Met Police...
What, so you're saying that these demonstrations and protests shouldn't go ahead?
No, I'm saying that the extreme elements of them need to be policed more effectively. And
but
that's not what's happening.
But, all right, you get a few being extreme, but I think that these protests, as I've said before, I would go there marching for a ceasefire. I'm not taking sides.
No, but I think
at all.
But Ingrid.
But I think that it's being misinterpreted. I think it is being actually almost deliberately misinterpreted. And also the other thing is, don't forget, he's Northern. He's right Northern. They just come out with... there's no filter, really.
Okay.
It's just...
Well, there's a lot for us to dissect there, but I think that if you want to go along to a protest in London and you want to protest the death of Palestinians and the fact that there isn't a ceasefire and the fact that actually that there are still Jewish hostages and that this whole awful mess is leading to...
There are many, many more Palestinians.
Yes, if you
Israel.
Want to protest all of that and the needless death of horrible of people and how awful
That's
all
what
this
it is.
Is,
it's the death.
Absolutely right on with you. If you're going to do that, great. But the moment that it crosses the line, which is happening, into intimidation towards people who don't agree with you, which there are elements of that happening.
But that happens, but now we're getting into kind of like more the racist, and now we're getting to very much sort of like, we are talking about then anti-Semitism and Islamophobia, and we're putting the two together. I do think that we have to separate this, and we have to think about the bridge between the two. And this is about a ceasefire. This is about peace.
Yes, but
this is about saving lives. But now it's becoming polarised.
But that's no reason not to police the extreme elements of any protest.
But
any
we've
protest.
Always had that. I went on demonstration marches in my teens for Vietnam. And you would get, if you like, extremists, because some people were much more passionate about it.
Well, that's wrong. Because on the streets of Britain, when you're closing Tower Bridge and setting off flares, when you're putting slogans on Big Ben...
What about during the miners' strike, when the people were literally getting beaten up and pummeled?
Well, that was wrong. There's no reason to turn a blind eye to those things.
It's human. It's human.
But I think...
And nothing was done about
But either way, it's a fair criticism. You may disagree, but it is a fair criticism that Sadiq Khan doesn't have control of those elements in London. Now, you may say that it's not as bad as a problem. That would be a fair point. I would disagree with that. But it's a fair point for Lee Anderson to make, to say, look, Sadiq Khan has lost control of this in his role as head of the Met Police. Mm. He has lost control of
but
that.
But he's not the only one in control. It's the government. There's arms...
Yeah, but he is mayor of London.
Yes, exactly. So but the thing is, you still then, behind that, you've got your whole team.
Fine.
You've got the Home Office, you've got all other people as well. But, so he hasn't got...
But that is a fair point to make. Whether you, again, that's a fair counterpoint. The problem that his comments had was this sort of, he's not got control because of the fact that he's a Muslim himself, so therefore it's all, I guess, an Islamist conspiracy.
I think that's an easy, I think it's a cop-out.
And that is
sorry,
what was implied.
and I would have
not worded it like that, because there is plenty to criticise Sadiq Khan about and his horrific record on policing London without bringing in the fact that he's Muslim himself. Plenty. And secondly, it's diverted attention away from what is a fair point.
Yep. Unfortunately, I think it's there's perhaps a subconscious thought there that, you know, there is a connection with him being Muslim and the people that are voting for him. And that is actually wrong, because you have to do it on merit,
Lee Anderson could have said, and I think there's a contingent of people that believe that Sadiq Khan is being controlled by Muslims. He could have said that, but he doesn't believe it himself. Again, but it's the fact that he sort of stated it as fact. And I think there is so much to criticise Sadiq Khan for. And what he's done is he's handed the moral high ground to Sadiq Khan. And now no one's talking about the failures of Sadiq Khan.
No
one's talking about how divisive Sadiq Khan has been in the past by saying that a photo of a white family isn't representative of London. Sadiq Khan himself has apologised for referring to moderate Muslims as Uncle Toms. He said that himself in an interview. Sadiq Khan has presided over more ethnic minorities being stabbed and killed in London than any other mayor in history. Sadiq Khan has has accused people who are against the ultra-low emission zone as being on the far right. I mean, you don't get a more divisive person. But now that divisive politician is able to say, well, look over there at that terrible racist over there. Mm. And I just think it's frustrating such an easy win has been handed because of stupid, and I'm sorry to say, what could be construed as racist comments.
Mm. I just think that everybody is looking for an excuse, and they are reading between the lines, like even in a book, you know, sort of like, oh, that can be interpreted as racist or transphobia or anything like that. I think that I get what Lee Anderson, the point of what he was trying to say.
Well, then why doesn't he clarify it? If he
Because, do you know, I think sometimes when you say something...
What do you think he was trying to say?
I just think he was just, you know, trying to say, you know, I think basically he was just trying to say that this man is an absolute prat and let's get him out of London.
But he didn't say that.
He didn't. But
I'm not trying to harangue you into having a different opinion. It's just frustrating that to me.
Well, let's get his exact quote, because then
I'll tell you what his exact quote was.
Right, because then you can see how it has been taken bit by bit by bit.
I don't actually believe. So he was responding to comments made by Suella Braverman. I don't believe that the Islamists have got control of our country, said Mr. Anderson.
Right, okay.
But what I do believe is they've got control of Khan and they've got control of London. He's actually given our capital city away to his mates.
Mm.
That's what he said about this. And I think that's implying that Sadiq Khan is mates with Islamists, which is extremists.
Well,
it's implying that he's deliberately given the capital over to those people because he's friends with them. Mm. And it's sort of tarring everyone who is Muslim with that brush. And if you were to say that about another religion or race, you would be absolutely hauled over the coals for it.
I mean, I don't know what his sort of like thinking is, and I don't think
you
should clarify because I think he's going to make it worse. No, I still don't see it that. I think the use of Islam is just giving it that little bit of...
Well, Islamist.
Or Islamist is giving it that edge because it is implying extremists. You know, if it said jihadist, then it would be like, oh, I get that. That is like, that's really a very fiery statement.
Well, I mean, Islamist is essentially jihadist. I mean, that's...
Would you say that?
Well,
I think that we have to be very careful how we interpret these words and not get too...
All right, well, let's see what some of... let's see what some of the people on the text are saying on this and on X. I did promise that I would read some of these. Custy says, wow, I actually agree with Ingrid today.
Oh, thank you.
Lee Anderson should not apologise for what he said because I believe what he said was true. Thank you for that. Chris doesn't like that we're talking about this because we're being too miserable. Jason says, Lee Anderson is right. And think about how does Khan get voted in? Most Londoners hate the man because it's a Muslim vote. But again, Jason, that's a different point.
Yes, it's this is it. This is what I was saying at the very beginning. You almost have to dissect
it. Yeah, I think you do.
But it is a point. It's a very good point.
Paul says, I enjoy you, Christo. I seldom agree with your politics, but you're engaging. Thank you. Funny and kind. Lee Anderson is racist. Worse, he uses racism to pander to the worst instincts of his followers. Why can't you say that plainly? Well, I have said it's a racist comment. I don't know whether that makes him racist through and through, but I think it was a racist comment. So there's no room for racism. Thank you for that. Another one here as well. Thomas says, sorry to annoy you, as I love you when you're on, but I like Lee Anderson and I somewhat agree with him. Khan gets votes from foreign nationals living in London. Thomas, again, that's a different point, though. That's
and
a fair
again,
point. That's a fair point.
It has opened up, actually, a can of worms, Lee Anderson's statement.
OK, Brian says, the irony of Ingrid describing Northerners as having no filter.
No. OK, I like it. Thank you. Touché.
We need more Lee Andersons, says Phil on the text. We support him. He's been suspended for telling the truth. I live in Nottingham, down the road from Ashfield, and Conservatives have now lost a lot if Ashfield votes because of this, because it will be more votes for reform. Nick says Lee Anderson is only saying what a lot of people think. I'm just going to try and fly through some of these now. Barry says Lee Anderson was spot on. We need more like him. Another one here, though, saying, I was a bit of a fan of Lee Anderson, but I now realise he's not clever enough to be an MP. I mean, I think that is a part of it as well, and I'm not trying to be horribly derogatory to Lee Anderson, but I think he's a bit of a I'll speak before I think kind of character. And I think that's his appeal, and I actually understand his appeal on that. But I think that that's not always useful as an MP. Margaret says, it's true what Lee Anderson said. Everyone's scared to agree with him. Where is freedom of speech? So
that's a great out. Where is freedom of speech? You see, freedom of speech, freedom of thought. I went to see Lee Anderson talk.
Oh, OK. Well, tell me about that. We're going to get to a break, but tell me about that when you come back. And I've got a great email as well about this, about why it isn't racism. So really interesting for us to discuss this. And we'll talk about a couple of other things. We'll do a little bit more on this. And then we will move on to Angela Rayner. And we might dredge up a couple of the things we spoke about yesterday as well, because I have a feeling you might be quite good on superstitions. Do you have any? I bet you do.
Yeah. I know loads of them. But yes,
great.
I do. And
all
I
right.
don't like to be superstitious, but
well.
I am.
when we return here on Talk TV.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV,
on radio,
online.
And
we're on your smart speaker.
Oh, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia. This is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing, let's look, don't look back in anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks. It said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the, you know, the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be your problem if they start breaking into people's homes, because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. And they can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I'll tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham, just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened? Whoa, missing.
There was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for the release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no, I've got you both.
Yeah.
You can't.
Good.
I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn, what is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised by a special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
Morning, it's Christo here on Talk TV, still on the roller coaster of Ingrid Tarrant, the broadcaster in the studio. A couple more texts and tweets. So you went to see Lee Anderson speak. We were talking about the Lee Anderson Sadiq Khan controversy. What did he have to say?
It was at a young Conservatives dinner. Hmm. And he was absolutely brilliant. And I was so fascinated. He was Labour, very, very Labour, coming from a mining family. He was a miner himself. And he was one of Corbyn's and all of the big Labour people, absolutely 100% behind them. I can't remember actually what sort of changed.
I think it was Brexit.
Oh, maybe it was Brexit.
I think it was Brexit. Yep. Which I'm always a tiny bit sceptical of people that change in such an extreme manner.
Oh, gosh.
Manner.
Well, look at Liz Truss. Look at Boris Johnson. They changed.
Yeah.
Completely. It was like sort of like backing a winner. But the thing was, he stayed with it. And if I do think that, again, Brexit polarised people enormously. You were either in or you were out. And that was that. And if it wasn't supported by his party, yes, of course, that was the reason.
Okay.
Anyway, he had very, very wise thoughts and thought processes.
Do you think then that this is him? He actually knows what he's doing when he says this.
I think probably with his statement yesterday was perhaps a little bit shooting from the hip.
Quite contrite yesterday, but he didn't apologise. He just said, "I realise I've put him in a position."
Honestly, don't think he should apologise. It's what he thinks, and I think we are going back to this.
All right.
Freedom of speech, freedom of thought. Let's say it. But I honestly don't believe he meant it to be racist and inflammatory.
Where I agree with someone emailing here, and I've said this a couple of times this morning, if you've missed it, Christo, it's not racist. Islam is a religion, not a race. Lee Anderson is completely right, and his words have been taken out of context and was meant towards the radical Islamism or left extremism that Sadiq Khan clearly sides towards. I agree with you. I'm a bit uncomfortable with it just being thrown as racism, because I think that there is a perhaps unfair conflation or a not legitimate conflation between the criticism of Islam, which I think is reasonable because it's an idea and race. So I would definitely call it sort of perhaps anti-Muslim. I'm not sure I'd call it racist by what he has said.
But you see,
every time I've said it's racist, I've said, well, because it's difficult.
And this is the problem.
But it's not,
there are so many layers to this.
But it's not. It's about the fact that it was Islamism. That's the word that I don't actually believe the Islamists have got control of our country, but I do believe Islamists have got control of Khan, and they've got control of London. I mean, basically, you're saying that extremists have got control of Sadiq Khan.
I don't think you are saying that, though. I really, really don't. Do you know, as I say, there are so many layers to this. There are so many different words, so many different adjectives that you can apply. And within that, you can decide how you want to interpret it.
Islamist, the dictionary definition of Islamism, an Islamist, is an advocate or supporter of Islamic fundamentalism, basically.
All right, so interpret fundamentalism then.
Okay.
Because again, you could see that exactly two ways. One could be
strict adherence. I mean, Islamist ideology is considered to be the fundamentalist sort of extreme ideology of Islam. And I think that to me is why this conflation between someone who is a mayor who is Muslim, therefore they must be in the hands of
extremists. But what is the fundamentalist? They're not going to smoke, they're not going to drink, they're not going to eat.
You're right about what is the definition of fundamentalism, but I think in day-to-day parlance, the term Islamism is considered to be extremist.
But it's become that. I do think that. I think it's become it. I think people have become so frightened of what they should be saying, so alert to and the prejudices here. I've said this a million times. I have been absolutely colorblind all my life, but now I'm becoming so aware. I'm looking at the commercials and I'm counting how many colored people and mixed race people there are on the commercials. You very rarely see one white person. So suddenly we're becoming very conscious.
Well, I absolutely agree.
Exactly. But the point is, we are now so focused on colour, religion, wording.
But that's no reason not to call it out when I think the wrong wording has been used. Especially when someone's had the opportunity to say, oh, do you know what, I worded that a bit badly. What I was saying was Sadiq Khan's lost control of London and that Islamist extremists are taking over London. I shouldn't have said they were his mates. Why couldn't he just say that? Is Sadiq Khan friends with extremists? I don't know. Is he?
Lee Anderson isn't necessarily saying that.
Well, he is. That's exactly what he said. His mates have taken over London.
But no. But you're now saying, now you're using the word Islamics as extremists.
Well, this because
like,
I think
he's calling us right wing.
Is it wrong then? What's right about
Islamists interpreting it that way as well.
But I call out Sadiq Khan for saying it's wrong. Or Lee Anderson should have said as well, here's the evidence. I have evidence here that Sadiq Khan and Islamists, those who are fundamental Islamists who are causing the problems at these protests, I have evidence that they are in cahoots with each other. Here is the evidence.
But that evidence, if there was evidence, it would always be hidden. We would never find it. We know what goes on in the corridors.
They don't say it.
No, but why should he? He's said enough.
Because it's an accusation that is not actually proven.
All right, then get Sadiq Khan to pursue him.
Well, maybe he should, but what Sadiq Khan is doing, because what Lee Anderson said
is probably right.
Well, you can't say that. You have to say you've no proof of that whatsoever. No. It's just an accusation. But what Sadiq Khan is now doing with it is sitting pretty, going brilliant. Now, all of the failures of me overseeing all of this is all now, none of that's being discussed because everyone's talking about Lee Anderson.
Well, let's see if Sadiq Khan defends himself then.
Well, he has. What he said,
Really, just milking it, because he could actually be putting himself in a big hole. This is going to be a powwow between the two of them. But actually,
he has said that Mr. Khan has said that that the claim that Islamists have got control of him as London mayor was Islamophobic. It sent the message that Muslims are fair game when it came to racism. He also said as well, Mr. Khan said, the comments from a senior Conservative are Islamophobic, they're anti-Muslim, they're racist. He then highlighted the spike in hate crime, saying these comments pour fuel on the fire of anti-Muslim hatred. He then attacked Rishi Sunak, saying, I'm afraid the deafening silence from Rishi Sunak and from the cabinet is them condoning racism. I'm afraid that it confirms to many people across the country that there's a hierarchy when it comes to racism. I'm unclear why Rishi Sunak isn't calling out condemning this. It's like they're complicit. The message it sends is Muslims are fair game. It's not good enough in 2024 in the United Kingdom. Sadiq Khan is loving this. Mm. Absolutely loving it. It is a win that has just been handed to him. So not only is it wrong what he said, but it's also giving Sadiq Khan the biggest gift in a lovely big bow, where he can now sit there and say, look at what a moral high ground I'm on. Yeah. And the man doesn't have the right to be on a moral high ground, because he's one of the most divisive. He's been said, I think, certain things that certainly from his office that could be accused of anti-white racism.
He had the Boris blow up Boris thing, didn't he? He has accused people
of being far right. He has done terrible things, Sadiq Khan, and now again it just deflects from all of that stuff.
Listen, this could be this will carry on. This will be a real powwow, and this will put a balance on that view.
All right.
Perhaps it's a good thing. It's a blessing in disguise, possibly.
Let's talk about Angela Rayner, because we've spoken about this for quite a while now. Hypocrite Rayner's £48,000 profit on a council house sale. That's the front page of today's Mail on Sunday. They're talking about the revelations from a book which is being released, which is an unofficial biography of Angela Rayner. And what it's outlining is that she made a £48,500 profit on her ex-council house thanks to her buying it at a discount on the right to buy policy. It's a policy that now, if Labour get into government, she wants to reform. Critics are saying that she wants to pull up the ladder and make it harder for other social housing tenants to benefit in the same way that she did, especially as she's now shadow housing secretary. Of course, Right to Buy, you'll remember, is the
That was brilliant, wasn't it?
The Margaret Thatcher policy, which has continued, where if you've lived in a council house for a certain amount of time, you can buy it at a discount from the council and therefore become a homeowner. It's Lord Ashcroft that has made these statements, has uncovered this in his book. Also, there was some strange goings on as well regarding she bought her council house with a £26,000 discount, but she was then registered on the electoral roll there from 2005 to 2015, though in 2010 she married someone and they were listed at two different addresses for that time. She gave her address as the original council house. Her husband gave an address a mile away. She re-registered her children's births, giving her address as the address of her new husband. And her brother was listed at the original council house from 2010 to 2014. But locals say that he did live there. But then she sold it in March 2015 and then made this profit from it.
You see, that I think
that's all a bit murky.
Yeah, it's very, very murky. The thing as well is that I think, if I remember correctly, once you had bought this, you had to live there
for a certain amount of time
before you could sell it. So you couldn't flip it. You couldn't do a quick turnover. So maybe it was that to satisfy the number of years that you had to be there.
Yeah.
And that would have been, 8 years afterwards. So maybe it was 5 years.
I don't know how long. She was a tenant in the Victorian house when she exercised her right to buy from the council in January 2007. She took out a mortgage to pay £79,000 for the two-bedroom property, having been given a £26,000 discount on its market value. of one quarter, and then she sold it in March 2015. And that was 7 weeks later, she became an MP, winning the Ashton-under-Lyme seat. I don't know how she wants to reform right to buy, but Labour obviously opposed the policy. Presumably, that's something that she would perhaps have to revisit. But now, the Mail on Sunday asked Ms Rayner a series of detailed questions. She only got a reply. They only got a reply from a Labour spokesperson. Whilst Belize-based Tory billionaire Lord Ashcroft kicks out at those who graft to get on in life, Lord Ashcroft being the author, Labour supports the principle that if you live in a council house and work hard, you should have the opportunity to own your own home. But we have committed to reviewing the unfair discounts introduced by the Conservatives in 2012. But Angela's purchase long predates that and was done by the book. So, interesting that they're saying that they're going to review the discounts. But if they review the discount to be anything lower than 25%, that will be hypocrisy from them, right? Because she got a 25% discount.
Yep. But what does it matter? I mean, really, she was doing... I mean, it is murky, the whole thing. Why was she having different addresses? And her husband's and her brother was there and all the rest of it. But that aside, completely that aside, just say it was just a clean thing that she did the right to buy. What would be the hypocrisy of doing a right to buy now at a different discount?
I because of the fact that she would have enjoyed a discount that she would then not allow others to enjoy. That's the hypocrisy. If she says, I'm not going to change the right to buy policy and a 25% discount is fine, then great. There is no hypocrisy. It's a non-story. If she presides as housing minister over a discount being reduced from 25% for right to buy, then she has benefited from a policy that she is then
changing. Yeah, but that was then and this is now. I think we're being too harsh. I can't bear the woman either. That's not one person I can't bear.
You're defending a lot of people.
Honestly, because the worse the older I get, the more grumpy I'm getting. I'm a grumpy old woman.
But yeah, so you don't mind this? You don't think this is a big story?
No, not really. I don't. I just think that was then, this is now. And actually, to reintroduce it would be absolutely brilliant because people do need that. All these other schemes that they've tried, where it's a shared purchase, where you own and then your payment over time contributes to your eventual ownership, it doesn't work. It hasn't worked. This was a very good scheme, in actual fact. Do you know what would be really good? Is to get tax relief on mortgages. To bring that back.
Oh, what you mean for landlords?
For everyone, any mortgage holder.
Because you know that if you're a landlord now, you don't get any tax relief on the mortgage that you pay. If you rent out a house for £20,000 a year and you pay £15,000,
and you don't get it for repairs either because it's seen as not maintenance but an improvement because it's an ongoing asset.
And what it's doing is it's making hard. Landlords leave the market, which is therefore putting up rents, which is therefore making it worse for tenants.
Exactly, it's really backfired, hasn't it? No, I'm saying for any person that's taking out a mortgage, anyone. For whatever reason, whether you're a landlord or not, but sort of
you
like
get tax relief on it.
You don't pay tax on that
portion of your income that goes towards the mortgage.
Exactly, which is how it used to be years ago.
I can't even imagine it being like that.
It was brilliant.
It is an absolute nightmare the way in which they are creating a situation where landlords are exiting the market, there isn't enough housing stock, and they think they're solving the problem when all they need to do is build more houses.
Now I have to say this is where every single day I hear that about three times a day, and I'm screaming at everybody, and now I'm kind of like screaming quietly out loud at you.
Why?
Because no, we don't have enough land. We have to preserve the land that we've got. They're trying to put through a building of 2,300, it's just gone under, well, just under 2,000 houses now, on Greenbelt, near where we live. It is farmland. It is fertile farmland. That is considered where we are. And also it's the wildlife.
But why do you have to build on the farmland? Why can't you build on Branfield?
They are building on Branfield, which they shouldn't be doing either. They should be utilising that. They should be repurposing office blocks because most of them are empty.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Yeah.
Or rebuild as well social housing to make it more, because a lot of it is quite badly designed and you could make it more densely populated.
There are streets and streets, yes, exactly.
But you would have to allow, what I find quite repellent about some of those is my council does that a lot and there are lots of social housing blocks and what they do is they say, right, you can't move back into them once we've rebuilt them. You know, we're going to move you out.
Well, you can't evict people. That's wrong. That's displacing. Yes.
Beautiful low-rise estate. I've got to be really quick because I've got to get to a break. But there's a beautiful low-rise estate in Brixton, not far from where I live, which is called Cressingham Gardens. And it was commissioned actually by John Major when he was head of Lambeth Council. And it's a beautiful low-rise estate which has a mix of houses and flats. It doesn't interfere with the vista of Brockwell Park because it actually hides behind all of the trees.
Oh, that's nice and sympathetic, which they don't do anymore.
It's beautiful. And it was like hailed as an amazing architectural masterpiece at the time. And Lambeth Council have allowed it to get into such a state of disrepair that now it's easier to rip it down. And what they want to do is build blocks overlooking the park. And they've told all the people that have lived in Cressingham Gardens for 50 years, we're moving you out. And by the way, you won't be able to come back in.
Why can't they be sitting tenants? Because I know somebody.
Well, they are. And it's been a big fight going on. But that's what a lot of councils are doing. And it's a nightmare. When we return, we'll talk about airlines, because I'm sure Ingrid's got a lot to say about those and that best and worst list, all here live on Talk TV.
Hey, very good morning to you.
Thanks for joining us.
You're with Talk TV on TV, on radio, online.
Oh, bless him, he's soaking wet.
The most likely situation is that statue is going to end up in M Shed, which is a museum just on the harbour.
Nick, when we first went to you, I thought you dived into the harbour to get the thing out, for God's sake, man. Well done, good job.
Islamism is sweeping our nation. This is not Islamophobia, this is real. Another terror attack, another killing of an MP. Oh, don't worry, let's light a candle, let's all sing Don't Look Back in Anger and sing Kumbaya.
He had a politically minded project called WikiLeaks, which said nothing about what was going on in the Kremlin, nothing about what was going on in China. There was a clear political bias in what he was doing.
This is the first time Milam has heard of asylum seekers coming to the town. If we are guinea pigs, then I think we should have been consulted.
This concept that actually kids wouldn't carry knives if they could go and play tiddlywinks at the corner of a street or whatever. I think it's a nonsense.
Well, it will be a problem if they start breaking into people's homes, because they can break into yours and decide that you're not doing enough. They can break into mine and decide I'm not doing enough. And I tell you what, if they break into my home, it will get violent, that's for sure.
It's not like, you know, they live in an average semi and where's Harry going to sleep? You might have thought he's come all the way. Couldn't he at least have spent a couple of days with them at Sandringham just, you know, to use the vernacular, chilling out a bit?
What are you doing? I'm just about to do it. Ooh! It's Carry On. What just happened? Ooh,
there was a suggestion by some that maybe it would be nice to put a statue of the Queen on the fourth plinth. Mr. Khan apparently wasn't too keen on that.
I'm sorry. I know what's coming and I can't stop laughing.
There are no banners calling for the release of the hostages.
They will not.
There are no banners, Kevin.
You can't say everyone on that march where we condemn Hamas. Sorry, no, I've got you both. I'm sorry.
Stop creating all of these funny little factions with their funny little names. The New Conservatives, the ERG, the Common Sense Research Group, the Red Wall, Red Trouser, Popcorn. I mean, Popcorn, what is that?
What on earth is going on in the House of Commons?
I'll try my very best to explain that, Daisy, but it is an extremely complicated situation.
This just absolutely stinks.
Neil Parish, he was great for his area. Rishi Sunak actually brought him out today and said, this guy's going to be advised by the special counsel.
If anybody can pull it off, it'll be him.
What?
Your mind.
It's not our mind, it's your mouth, Mr.
Unbelievable.
Talk TV. It's the only place where you get the truth.
Thank you. Morning, it's Christo here on Talk TV, still joined in the studio by the broadcaster Ingrid Tarrant. Now, Ingrid, I don't know whether you are someone who is au fait with this story, but yesterday we were talking about, well, it was two stories that sort of ended up being combined, and I got such a massive response to them that I thought I would bring them up again today. And that is the number of germs that are hiding in the cinema. Did you know that cinema seats have 14 times as many bugs? Well, actually, it's the cup holders and things like that than your average toilet. Did you know that?
No, I didn't. Yeah. Wait a minute, what are you talking about, the cups?
Yeah, the cup holders in cinemas.
Yeah, so that's where the bugs are concentrated. Bugs
and the seats and all of these sorts of things. But also, because we were talking about airlines, I was talking about how I disinfect my area whenever I get onto an aeroplane.
Do you really?
I take a wipe and I wipe everywhere on the airline. When I sit down, I wipe the board, I wipe the back of the seat, I wipe the armrests.
No.
Yeah, I absolutely do, because they're so grubby. I don't touch the handle when I go into the toilet.
Ever?
On an airplane, if I can get away with it. If I'm wearing a T-shirt, I take a tissue and I use that for the...
But
the
only toilet. On an airline, not... You wouldn't do it on a, let's say, a train.
In a train, definitely.
What about in a pub?
Same, absolutely.
Restaurant?
Everywhere. I don't like touching handles on toilets. Especially boys. Boys don't wash their hands.
No, they don't.
And then if you've got... when I rule the world...
Yes.
Every single...
Can I rule it with you?
Yes.
Good, OK.
You can be... I don't know what cabinet position I'll give you. I don't know what it will be. You could have Norway.
Oh, Norway.
I'll give you Norway. All right. She's Norwegian. She can have Norway. When I rule the world, every single toilet door when you leave a toilet will be a push door, so you can use your foot.
Oh, that's interesting.
Because it's the fact that you
have to... Have you been to Japan?
No. Would I like that?
Yes, you would.
Is it very clean?
Extremely, and especially the loos. Everything in the loo is just clinically clean.
Because it's the idea, especially in a pub, that you've got to go to the loo in a pub, and people have been using a urinal. There is nothing more grim than a urinal, firstly. And then they don't wash their hands after having used the urinal, and then they open the door with a handle.
I know.
It's disgusting, especially in a pub that serves food. And then I've got to go and sit and eat my food. Are you kidding? So I always use a sleeve or... I like a towel.
A wet towel.
Or you have sanitizer on it, because it's disgusting.
What about mints?
Would you ever have
a mint on a bar?
No. Oh, no.
Haven't
they found, like, 75 different types of urine and body fluids and things like that? Never. The first thing I always do when I walk into my house, wherever I've been anywhere, is wash my hands. That's the first thing I do.
I do that because not because I'm scared about the germs. It's just actually that I get a little bit kind of just grubby. I love white sinks because then I can see kind of like the dirt come off.
Yeah, but how dirty do you get?
Oh, a little
bit. I don't think I'm ever that dirty.
No, but like this morning it'll be like the papers and I touch on that. And
So do you have any little rituals like that?
No, do I?
Are you quite dirty?
No, I'm not dirty.
Okay.
I'm a dirty girl, but I'm clinically... I'm a filthy girl. I'm a potty mouth girl. I call myself very hygienic, but not obsessive like that. I think I'm completely normal. I always wash my hands after going to the loo. I always wash my hands when I come in from being out
somewhere,
sort of like shopping and everything.
Apparently, according to the research... Internal bathroom door handles are the dirtiest, with an average of 93 bacteria colonies per centimetre square of surface. This is almost 8 times dirtier than the toilet seat. Another hotspot for germs is the kitchen, with food and cutlery cabinets hosting 4 times as many bacteria colonies as a toilet.
Oh, that's interesting. But now the thing is, the only area, I suppose, it gets a little bit difficult because there's going to be germs out everywhere. This will be littered with germs.
Oh, I know this will be.
Imagine. I don't want to freak you out. You'll be running out here.
Well, look
now.
Look at the, where these are in here.
Oh, for goodness sake. You really are obsessive. It's OCD, really, isn't
it? Well, I was talking about this yesterday and I think it is a bit OCD because I was saying the other thing I do when I get on a plane is I've got to touch the outside of the plane when I get on.
Oh, like a good luck thing. Get me just have there
to,
safely.
Yeah, just get me there safely. Just put my hand on the outside of the fuselage. Mm. Which
but
is
can I just say
grubby.
Very quickly, because that's a superstition, which I'll get onto another thing, which is kind of like odd when you're doing the thing. But it only matters enormously about all these germy places, handles, on planes, etc., etc., if you tend to put your fingers
in your mouth,
oh. on your face, whatever. But if you don't...
Yeah, I see. I do a lot of touching of my face.
Oh, well, then that's probably why... You see, I don't. I'm not kind of like stick my finger
in my
mouth.
I'm an incubus of plague. I am just the plague.
You're the plague. But you have to be careful as well, Christo, because you can be too clean
yeah, I know,
and you
I
won't
understand.
Have any resistance.
No, I know,
you
I do.
You need to have a robust immune system. You need to have a few germs.
But
lots
I got such a response when I spoke about the superstitions that my mother has ingrained in me. We got such a response yesterday to all of that and the
it's
fact that
fascinating,
she she'll cross herself when she's about to take off on a plane. Some of them are a bit religious. She won't.
Does she touch the ground with her head when she gets off the plane
no,
on
she's
the
not
tarmac?
The Pope.
Well, no, but it's not only the Pope that does that. But she crosses her heart going on
you don't
the plane.
Get to the, you don't get to the tarmac anymore, anyway. I used to love the days
yes,
when you used
do.
To walk. Very rarely, you usually got one of those tunnels.
I suppose you do.
I used to like walking
that,
up
yes.
the plane stairs.
Do you know, it's a half and half. Because just recently...
You must go from very small airports, quite cheap airports, I imagine.
I do, because
Terminal 5, you don't go anywhere near the plane.
Well, sometimes you do, because you have to take the bus. Because Heathrow's not always that efficient.
Actually, once I landed at Heathrow, and I think we landed at Gatwick, because the bus ride was
That's
so long
really
from the
bad.
Plane. you're probably right. It was so long, actually. I was like, I think we've landed at Terminal 2.
Oh, crumbs.
And it was a Terminal 5 flight because they had nowhere to put us. Okay, the best... I need a bubble wrap suit, says Wayne. We should see with my top off. It does resemble that. the best and worst airlines. I revealed some of these yesterday. So the worst, without a doubt, British Airways, unfortunately...
The worst
short haul.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me.
Oh, no, it was Wizz, sorry, because it's done. They've done it in reverse order. So fifth worst was British Airways. The worst was Wizz Air. Mm. Have you ever flown Wizz Air?
No, never, but I've seen them. And I've seen TUI as well. They suddenly appeared, didn't they, around about the same time. Have you flown Wizz?
I think I've flown Wizz once. My parents fly it sometimes because they're the only airline that do... that go from Luton to Athens, because obviously my parents go to Athens a lot. And I've told them now, go to Heathrow, because...
Doesn't Ryanair go from Luton to Athens?
I don't think so.
I wouldn't put my parents
on Ryanair. I think Luton Airport is one of the grimmest places that you could actually visit
it's
in the world.
It's so quick to get through, though. It's not busy.
Look, City Airport...
Oh, City Airport,
now,
that's a good one.
Lovely.
I love
a bit of City Airport.
It's kind of still quite old-fashioned,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, I like City Airport because it's so quick.
Yeah.
And you know, and there's no... You're right, there's no frills. You just get... But I don't want frills. I just want to get through.
That's
I
exactly
just want to get through. Get me on the
get
plane.
Get from A to B. Have a little sandwich on the way over.
But the reason I thought of you and telling you about this today, because I'm going to Sadiq Khan you now.
Oh, God.
Because you are now representative.
Oh, yeah.
Because Norwegian came third as the best short haul. And, of course, you're Norwegian and you represent all Norwegians.
I like to think that wouldn't that be marvellous if I did? Norwegian is actually brilliant. And I'm not saying that because I'm not being biased. It is actually brilliant. So that came in off the back of Ryanair and all the no-frills, EasyJet and so on. And obviously they realised and took learned a lesson a little bit. So there was extra legroom anyway, instead of being knees under your chin and everything. The service is fantastic. The staff are superb. Mind you, I do love the staff on EasyJet.
Oh, I like the staff.
I think they're fabulous. They're very, very amusing,
we have
all of them.
Ongoing joke, myself and my partner, because we flew EasyJet once and the steward came on and said, and we have a full service today, including vodka, everything, or if you fancy, champagne.
Yeah, I love it. They are comedic.
So now, near my partner saying, what do you fancy to drink? Would you like champagne? It's ridiculous. I tell you what, it's a brilliant airline from Heathrow, Aegean to Greece.
Is it?
You get a seat. You get.
Well, you'd hope you'd get a seat with every airline.
No, but like, you just get to choose it.
Oh, really? But what, first come, first serve then?
No. I mean, when you're booking, you get to choose your seat.
Free. Yeah, but you can with other airlines.
Yeah, not with most of them.
Yes, you
can. You get a meal. You get a brand new plane, you get everything. It's a, like a proper airline. When I got onto an Aegean the other day, the captain was greeting people. I was like, there's a captain.
They're not doing automated jet. Yes, but no, I've had that. That's not unique.
He was. I really liked that. I thought it was very old-fashioned, and he was a lovely. Well, I say he could have been. I assumed his gender identity there.
Good morning.
Maybe he was
a man. Good morning, Ingrid. How lovely to see you. Good morning, Christo.
Morning, David Bull. How are you?
I'm all right,
thank
you.
How was your visit to Donny?
It was brilliant, you know. I left here, went up to Doncaster, spoke at the conference, 1,200 people in the audience. There was a real sense of optimism. It was great. I absolutely loved it.
Will you be talking about that today?
I will, but obviously, hopefully in a non-partisan way. But obviously, it's all over the papers. Lee Anderson, of course, Nigel Farage offering, extending an olive branch to Lee Anderson. It's fascinating. The whole thing is fascinating. Were the Conservatives right to remove the whip from Lee Anderson? Judging by the comments on social media, many people are furious about what's going on. He expressed an opinion. When can you not do that?
Well, I mean, we've had little powwow about this.
I do think he was wrong.
Do you?
What he's done is he's given Sadiq Khan the moral high ground, and I think that no one's now talking about what could have been a fair point, because I think what he was saying about the fact that there is an extreme element in the protests in London is absolutely reasonable.
Of course.
But to make the connection that they're Sadiq Khan's mates, I think, as now, no one's talking about that now. Everyone's talking about racism.
You know, but they will talk and talk and talk about it, and it'll expose it all, and it'll expose much more.
So meanwhile,
you've
got the SNP then tabling another motion on Gaza. When it can't get any more ridiculous in the House of Commons, it continues to get more.